Bible, six different characters in the Bible from the Old Testament to the New Testament, where there was a, for such a time as this moment, particularly obviously with Esther, that's where the story comes from. But next week I'm looking at Joseph and just seeing the things that happened in his life, the for such a time as this moment that happened in his life that actually basically changed the course of history and enabled a whole country, country of Israel, to come into Egypt to survive the 7 years of drought. We're going to talk about that next week. This week, I just want to talk about a story I was reading this week from Luke chapter 8, when Jesus was in Capernaum and he crossed over the other side of the lake. The disciples didn't know where he was going, but it was to save one person. And we're going to read that story right now. It's called Jesus and the Demoniac. And it's from Luke 8, 26 to 39. So I'm going to read that down to us from Luke 8, 26 to 39. And my Bible says, Jesus restores a demon-possessed man. They sailed to the region of the Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me." For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of him, out of the man. Many times it had seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot and kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" "Legion," he replied, because many demons had gone into him. And they begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding them in the hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. When the demons came out of the man, they went into the pigs, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and countryside. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. Then all the people of the region of the Gerasenes asked Jesus to leave them, because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. The man from whom the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, "Return home and tell how much God has done for you." So the man went away and told all over the town how much Jesus had done for him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we read your word, as we open your word, Lord, open our eyes, open our heart through your Holy Spirit. Speak to us, Lord, what you want us to hear tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so tonight's an interesting story because Jesus left a busy schedule ministering to hundreds, maybe thousands of people in Capernaum. And he goes across to a little place in the Gerasenes, probably Samaritans, not the Israelite people, but probably Samaritans, and a small group of people. One man, he went across for one man, this demon-possessed man. When I attended Bible college, one of the things we did, we studied doctrines. So it's like a religious belief based on scriptural evidence. So I studied things like the doctrine of Christ, the doctrine of man, we did the doctrine of angels. We also did the doctrine of Satan and the doctrine of demons. So it's a scriptural insight on a particular topic. And so that was what we studied. And so in Bible college, I was taught the doctrine of demons and the doctrine of Satan. And it made me really think, particularly after reading this story, that yes, Satan exists. Yes, the demons do exist. And they unfortunately inhabit people, they inhabit situations, and in this story, they inhabit animals. So I just wanted to briefly look at these doctrines. Before we go into this story, just briefly look at these doctrines that I study, because I think it helps us to realize that Satan is real. Because some people try and say Satan isn't real. Well, he is. He's real. Demons are real. And hell is real. We see that in the Bible. We see that in the New Testament. We see it in the Old Testament. So what we're going to do now is just quickly just go through the doctrine of Satan. I just took some little notes out of my notes from many years ago. And the first thing we see with the doctrine of Satan is that we see the teaching in Scripture in the Holy Bible. So we've got the existence of Satan is taught in seven Old Testament books. Okay, so seven Old Testament books talk about Satan. Every New Testament writer talks about Satan. So every New Testament writer. So there's evidence of Scripture. We also have got the teaching of Jesus, the teaching of Christ. He acknowledged and he taught the existence of Satan. So we've got some verses coming up now. And this is Jesus, Matthew 13:39. And it says, and the enemy, and this is the story of the sower and the seed, and the enemy who sows him is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvest is their angels. So the enemy who sows him is the devil. So Jesus talked about the devil. Another passage of Scripture. This is in Luke 10:18. He said, he replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And this is when he sent out the 72. Remember, they came back. And as they were seeing people run for the Lord, as people, miracles were taking place, he said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. And then another verse. This is Jesus' teaching. Luke 11:18. If Satan, this is when he was talking to the Pharisees, if Satan is divided against himself, how can his kingdom stand? I say this because you claim that I drive out demons by Beelzebub or by the devil. So he talks about Satan. So three particular instances in the New Testament, Jesus talks about Satan. So you've got the teaching of Scripture, you've got the teaching of Jesus, and then you've also got the personality and nature of Satan. So these are the personality traits. Now, I haven't got these scriptures up, but you can write them down if you want. Firstly, we're told that he's a murderer, John 8:44. And we're also told that he's a liar, which is in John 8:44. We also know that he's a confirmed sinner, 1 John 3:8. He's also an accuser of the brethren, Revelation 12:10. And he's also our adversary, which we see in 1 Peter 5:8. So we've got teaching of Scripture, teaching of Christ, and then the personality and nature of Satan. Now, a few more notes, and I'll turn over. Limitations, Satan's limitations. One, he is a creature and therefore not omniscient or infinite like God is. Okay, so he's just a creature. Two, he can be resisted by a Christian, and we see that in James 4:7. We're going to talk about that later. And thirdly, God places limitations on him, and we read that in the story of Job 1:12. Now, doctrine of Satan, now we look at the doctrine of demons. More of my notes. Demons are fallen angels. Satan is an angel, and is called the prince of demons, and that's Matthew 12:24. Satan has well-organized ranks of angels, and we know that. We see that in Ephesians 6:11-12, when we're talking about the it's not a battle against flesh, but against principalities and powers, and the organized ranks of the angels that Satan has. Now, the activity of demons. Demons attempt to thwart the purpose of God. We read that in Daniel 10 and also in Revelation 16. Demons can inflict disease, Matthew 9:33, in Luke 13:11-16. They also possess people, in Matthew 4:24. They possess animals, as we see in the story today in Mark chapter 5. They also oppose the spiritual growth of God's children, Ephesians 6:12. And they also teach false doctrine, 1 Timothy 4:1. And one more thing about the demons, it's got nothing to do with the team that's playing today. I just thought I'd add that. So we've got the demons that are playing today, it's got nothing to do with that. It's got nothing to do with the doctrine of demons. When we lived in Narracourt, the Narracourt footy club was called the Narracourt Demons, and I always used to feel, it didn't seem right, so I just called them the D's. So they just got called the D's, not the demons. But anyway, that's another story. Now, destiny for demons. Eventually, all demons will be cast with Satan into the lake of fire, Matthew 25:41. Now, I just took some of those notes out of my old Bible college notes, just to reinforce that, yes, Satan is real. The devil is real and hell is real. It's in the Bible, said by Jesus, seven Old Testament books, and all the New Testament's full of it. And so today's story is just one of those many stories when Jesus and his disciples confronted a demon. in this man. So they're traveling over, and we see this probably young man, and it says that he's tied up with chains. Not just a bit of rope, he's tied up with chains, but not inside the town, outside the town, in the cemetery, in the tombs. So he's away from the town. One of those sad parts, they don't know how to handle this guy. So what do they do? Out of sight, out of mind, he's out in the tombs. No clothes, because he can't keep them on, probably badly undernourished, and he's living in a cold nights, hot days, and he's probably suffered terribly. And the Bible tells us that there were certain times when the demons took over him, that he just was out of control. Now, I've got chains on my boat trailer to keep the car from leaving the car, and they're very strong. And it's only come off once because I've got the hitch on properly, and the chains saved me. Now, I don't know how a man can break chains, but I'll let you know that Satan and his demons do break chains, unfortunately, and they stop people from living a normal life. This man started off just like you and I, like a normal person, but somewhere along the line, he got involved in some demonic activity where he allowed not just one demon, but legions of demons to come into his life. And so Jesus confronts this man and the demons inside of him, gets the name, and then asks them, and interestingly enough, has a dialogue with the demons. Now, I've seen people cast out demons, Christian people casting out demons, and I've never actually seen asking them to name them and just cast them out in Jesus' name, as we can. But for some reason, Jesus had a dialogue, a conversation with these demons. And the conversation went something like this: "We don't want to go back to the pit. We don't want to go back to hell where we came from. Can you please send us out into the pigs?" Which seems a really strange request. But when you read into the story, there's probably reason for this, because Jesus knows what's going on. But anyway, he grants their request, and all these demons leave this man and go into all these pigs. And the Bible tells us that the pigs rush straight into the lake and were drowned. Now, what we need to realise that these Samaritans would have had pigs, because the Israeli people wouldn't eat pig. So it's an unclean animal, but for the Samaritans it's not. So these pigs, it's their livelihood. It's just like you've got your pigs at home, or you've got your sheep on your farm or your cattle, and it's what you live by. And so these people, this is their income, probably their sole income, and a very good income. And so what's happened is that the demons have been cast out by Jesus into the pigs. The pigs have gone into the water and drowned. And the people looking on all the herds and think, "We've just lost our job." And so they go back into town and tell a story, something to all the townspeople. So they didn't say, "Hey, so-and-so's been cured." They said, "We've lost our income. We've lost our pigs." And the Bible tells us that they were full of fear. Instead of being so happy that someone had come to their right mind, you think about it. Can you imagine having someone on the outer that you don't want to be near? Now, I remember walking through one of the towns on our trip, and just a little town, and there was one person that wasn't in their right mind. And it was sort of freaky, because they didn't so much scare you. You didn't know what was going to happen, whether they're going to scream at you, shout at you, because they were asking for money. And I felt uncomfortable. Now, the best thing that probably could have happened was to get rid of that person, but I think one of the shop owners knew them and actually sit them down and give them a coffee to quiet them down. But it's interesting, we don't know what to do with people that allow that they've got mental health issues, but for this person had major mental health issues because of the demonic activity in his life. And yet when Jesus cast the demons out, this man was a totally different person. The first thing they did was put clothes on him. And the Bible says that he was in his right mind. So the people come down, and instead of rejoicing that one person had been saved, the angels in heaven were rejoicing, the disciples were rejoicing, Jesus was rejoicing, but the people were not rejoicing. They were angry, they were fearful, they were angry because they'd lost their income. That's all they could think about. Now, I challenge myself when I hear this story, because I think, how would I react? Jesus came along, or a Christian came along, and something incredibly happened in my town, but it meant me losing my job, because that's basically what's happened. So they've lost their income, they've lost their job. But I would hope that I would be thinking, praise the Lord, something incredible has happened, a changed life has taken place. And unfortunately, nobody had that attitude. All of them had the attitude, just get lost, Jesus, we don't want you, you've wrecked our income, you've wrecked our town, instead of saying, wow, this person has had a changed life. Incredible. This person is now changed. This person lived in the gutter, in the graves, it was no clothes, and could break chains, now in their right mind, dressed, and listening to Jesus. But I love this story because when you think about it, Jesus listened to the demons and gave them their request, but when this man came to Jesus and said, take me with you, as it had been on telly, he said, take me with you. Well, that's what he said, take me with you. And what did Jesus say? He said, no, no, and no, I want you to stay and be a missionary in your town. And I love that last verse when it says, so the man went away and told all over town how much Jesus had done for him. Isn't that great? That's exactly what he did. He went back into his town and became a missionary in his town. The town hoped, the town misfit, but no one wanted, suddenly became the missionary in their own town, sharing Jesus in that community. Beautiful story, a bit like the Samaritan woman at the well that went away and said, I want to tell you what Jesus did for me. That, I just think that is a beautiful story of redemption and a beautiful story of Jesus recognizing that the most important thing for this man was not to come with him, but to be a missionary in his town. Just like we're challenged today to be a missionary in the south coast of Victor Harbour. Okay, so as I thought about this story, I thought, you know, this man, somewhere along the line, something happened in his life to change him. And I'm thinking, sometimes it's just little things in life that trigger a slide, a slippery slide into the abyss. Sometimes it's just anger. A little thing just like anger. Sometimes we get angry. Well, I read in Ephesians 4:26, do not sin, do not allow yourself to sin. Don't go to sleep at night with anger in your heart. So anger. What about forgiveness? Simple thing like forgiving people. What did Jesus say? Forgive those who sin against us. So we've been forgiven, so we need to forgive people as well. Jesus said that in the Lord's Prayer. So anger. It can go from a small little thing to a big thing. Forgiveness. If we don't forgive one person, we don't forgive other people. And sometimes it's forgiveness that's been going on for a whole generation, sometimes for a whole lifetime, where people have failed to forgive. What about looking inappropriately at something? Or my thought life? What did Jesus say in Matthew 5:29? He said, if your right eye causes you to sin, literally pluck it out. Because he said it's better if you have no eyes than to keep thinking wrong thoughts. My thought life? Looking inappropriately at things. And what about my tongue? What does it say in James 1:26? Keep a tight rein on your tongue. The Bible tells us, don't give the devil an opportunity. Because there's this roaring lion just behind us. And it talks about, 1 Peter 5:8 talks about this roaring lion just waiting to devour us. Because that's what Satan is. He's just waiting to devour us. And you know, there are little things like anger and forgiveness or unforgiveness. Looking inappropriately. A bad thought life. All these little things. You know, only takes one little thing, and this roaring lion is just standing around the corner just watching us, waiting for the opportunity just to sink the old teeth and the claws in. And you know, it only takes one little lie, one little wrong thought, when those claws can get dug in, and it gets to a stage where before we know it, we're the prey, we're the hunted, we're the prey. And I believe that this young man that we looked at the story today was exactly that person. Just one, you know, one inappropriate thought life, one inappropriate act of just silliness. We don't know. It could have been something as simple as, I know people think, oh, it's okay to go to a seance. It could have been as simple as going to a seance. We don't know. But one little thing happened, and unfortunately, the claws came in and got this man. And so it looked one little thing and to a bigger thing, to a bigger thing, to a bigger thing. Somewhere in his life, something went wrong. And Satan got a foothold into his life, and it became a stronghold. And that's what happens in people's life. This little foothold becomes a stronghold. And you might say, it would never happen to me. And hopefully it never does. But I want to go back to that very first story I talked about this afternoon, about Google Maps. And you know, I believe Google Maps is a bit like Jesus. You know, we can take the wrong path, and what does Google Maps do? It tells us it's going to redirect, you're going to reroute. It tells you in an American voice, I'm going to reroute or redirect to a new path. And you know, I believe that's how Jesus works with us. We can make a silly mistake. We can get angry. We can not forgive people. Our thought life becomes inappropriate. We say the wrong things. But instead of a God coming down and saying, you are wrong, how dare you, I'm going to strike you from this planet. God doesn't work like that. What he does is he redirects, he reroutes, and allows us to have another opportunity to keep walking in the path that he wants us to walk in. And Google Maps and Jesus are a little bit alike. Just read, you make a wrong turn like I did, I could have kept going, but Google Maps redirected me to the right way. And that's what Jesus does, he redirects us onto the right path. But you know what, eventually, Google can't help us. And if I'd kept staying on that track last week, I would have ended up basically in a, I don't know, in a box somewhere, because there was nothing on the map, there was nothing left. And that's what happens in some people's life. For this young man, he was almost at that point of no return. And some people just keep pushing and pushing and pushing and keep getting involved in the wrong things. And there comes a point in time where it's too late. Where it's too late. But you know what I'm saying today? It is not too late for any one of us here. If we've said wrong things, if we've done wrong things, if we haven't been able to forgive people, we can correct that right now. And just ask Jesus to come into our life again and to expose those areas in our life that we need to get right. Because that's what this young man was able to do with Jesus. He was able to, in his tracks, start again, redirect, reroute his track, and start again on a new track. And that's what I love about Jesus. The man was willing to allow Jesus to set him free. And you know what? He had chains, but he broke them in his own strength. But then when Jesus came along, he broke that chain forever. He released those chains forever, so he never had to wear chains again. See, man puts chains on people, but Jesus releases from the chains. He breaks the chains. He breaks those curses that are on us. He breaks all those, the sin in our life. He breaks the things in our life that are stopping us from moving forward. And so as we finish on this story today, I guess my main focus is to think the fact that Jesus was able to come and see into this man's life and see the potential in this man's life and turn his life around. And you know, I love the fact that Jesus will go out and leave the 99 and find that one. And maybe that's what we need to do this week. You know, leave the comfort of the 99 and go out and find that one person this week. You know, there's someone on your heart, maybe right now, that you need to see this week. Because if Jesus hadn't gone to that person, he may have gone to the Google Maps, might have let him come back. We don't know, do we? But Jesus came. And so, I guess my message tonight is that as you think about this week, is there that one person that's chained somewhere waiting to be released? Because that could be what Jesus has asked you to do this week, to find that one person so that you can help to release them from the captivity they're in, the demonic life that they're living. Now, sometimes we think, oh no, there's no way they could be influenced by demons. Well, if you're not living a Christian life, well, you will be influenced by Satan, by Satan and demonic activity. Because unfortunately, the Bible tells us that Satan is roaming to and fro like a roaring lion. He's here and he can easily grab, but he won't. Because we're a Christian. The blood of Christ enables us to stand firm. Satan has no authority over any one of us or anybody else in our surroundings, because we have the confidence, we have the message of the blood of Christ that was shed for us. And when we claim the blood of Christ and the risen Saviour, we have the confidence to know that Satan cannot touch us. So just remember that he cannot touch us. But what we can do is we can go out and be that person to help redeem those people, to release the chains of those people that have been bound by Satan and his demons. So I encourage you this week, as we look at this story, to remember that one that's been chained somewhere in the South Coast or in Adelaide or somewhere in South Australia that needs to be released, and you're probably that person that needs to be that person to go out to see them. So I'll ask the band to come up now as we close off. And can I encourage you, as the band comes up, to think about, I mean, we are low in numbers, but to think about Tuesday night. Because I want to use Tuesday night. Initially it's only once a month, but it will be more regularly. We have a Bible study at our house on Tuesday night, but once every, the fourth Tuesday of every month, we come here, we meet together, we have a short Bible study devotion, and then we share communion together. We pray for our church, we pray for any other, whether it's our church, our leaders, you know, whatever's on our heart. And then we just have that moment of 15 to 20 minutes of silence where we ask God to speak to us. We just have a whiteboard, we can just write our thoughts down. And as God speaks to us, and it's not going to necessarily come through the pastor, it could come through any one of us. God's given us all a gift to reach out to pray. And we need to know, as a church, what we're going to be doing next year, the year after. Well, I believe it's in these prayer times that God's going to speak to us and open up doors of opportunity for us as a church. So can I encourage you, as we close off in this last song, to think about Tuesday night, and to think about too the people that are broken and scattered. It says broken and scattered in pieces. You know, there's people out there that are broken and scattered and in pieces. And you know, Jesus is he's got this incredible way of bringing a jigsaw together. You know, there can be pieces all over the place. It's impossible for us to put back together, but Jesus puts us back together and it's by his amazing grace. So as we sing this song, as we're thinking of that person that God wants us to reach out to this week, I just pray that God will speak through in this time.
You're welcome to stand, if you can.
Take a
raised to life eternally. So know that when it says, laying yourself down, that is Jesus doing that for us, taking our sin, taking his shame, taking the penalty of sin, sin which is death, physical death. He's raising us up. He's raising us up, but for his purpose. So this week, please be listening to what the Spirit is speaking to you. That voice, to go and say something to a stranger, to talk to someone that God's placed on your life. We have been raised up and restored to be effective members of his kingdom, and that's who we are, the body of Christ. Thank you, Jesus.